Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord on this second Sunday of Advent. It's wonderful to see each and every one of you with us. Also, those who join online as well, we're just so grateful to see you once again. This morning, some of our announcements are that we do have our angel tree out in the narthex, and that is where we pick a name, a little girl, a little boy, with Little Schoolhouse, which is one of our partner ministries, and we get one item of clothing, it has a size, and one toy. So we hope you'll participate in the angel tree. We also have some ongoing ministries where we collect canned goods and socks and toiletries. Some of those will go on over to Hope, South Florida. Others in our back door, we have a neighborhood homeless area that we also take them to. So we hope you'll help with that as well. I know we have our staff Christmas offering, and I think Len is going to share a little bit about that as well.
Good morning. My name is Lynn Strickland. I serve on the Staff Parish Relations Committee. The United Methodist Book of Discipline tells us that the Staff Parish Relations Committee shall reflect biblically and theologically on the role and work of our pastor and staff as they carry out their leadership responsibilities for the church. There is much work and many responsibilities carried out each week and all year long by our pastor and our staff to keep our church running. Caring for the pastor and staff of our church is not just the responsibility of Staff Parish Relations Committee, but it's the responsibility of all of us. In 1 Thessalonians 5:12, we read, "And now, my friends, we ask you to honor these leaders who work so hard for you, who have been given the responsibility of urging and guiding you along in your obedience and service. Overwhelm them with your appreciation and love." One of the ways that our church has traditionally demonstrated its appreciation and love for our pastor and staff is through our staff love offering given during the Christmas season. In the back of each pew, you will find a staff love offering envelopes. Please take one and show your appreciation and love as you are able. You may drop the envelopes in the pedestals at the exit as you leave the sanctuary after the service. You may also give online or by mail. Please make your gift by December the 15th so that our staff can enjoy it as they celebrate the holiday. Let us show our pastor and staff lots of Christmas love this year. Thank you.
Opening hymn.
Thank you. For the second week of Advent, we focus on peace. In John 14:27, Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid."
Let us pray. Prince of Peace, reveal yourself to us today. We need peace in our lives, our homes, our families, our church, and the whole world. Help us to slow down and seek out the peace you provide, so we may become peacemakers for ourselves and others. In your name, Prince of Peace, we pray. Amen.
And now may we share together by affirming our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Gifts to bring, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum-pum-pum-pum-pum-pum-pum-pum-pum-pum. Peace on earth, can it be? Years from now, perhaps we'll see the day. Must be made to care. give all the love that he can. I pray my wish will come true for my child and your child too.
Our first lesson in Scripture comes to us from the prophet Isaiah, over 700 years before the babe was born in the manger. Hear now the word of God. And a shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of power, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. And the wolf will live with the lamb, and the leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear, their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the hole of the cobra, and the young child put his hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. In that day, the root of Jesse will stand as a banner for all the people, and the nations will rally unto him, and his place of rest will be glorious. And from the New Testament, first from the Gospel of John, chapter 16, verse 33. And Jesus said, I have told you these things, so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. And then finally from Galatians 5, 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with passion and desire. And since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking and envying each other. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your presence. May my words become your message for each of us, your people. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue today on our Advent journey. Now in the second week of Advent. If you remember, Advent comes from that same root word in the Latin, adventus, which means adventure or coming or arrival. And today, it is the message of peace. Over 50 years ago, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. delivered a sermon on God's vision of nonviolence as a path to world peace. In this message, he eloquently reminds us that our loyalties must transcend our race, our tribe, our class, our nation. We must either learn to live together as brothers, or we will all perish together as fools. He paid tribute to the prophets like Amos and Micah and Isaiah when he declared, "I still have a dream that one day justice will roll down like water and righteousness like a mighty stream. I still have a dream that in all our state houses and city halls, persons will be elected to go there who will do justly, who will love mercy, who will walk humbly with their God. I still have a dream today that one day war will come to an end, that men will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks, and that nations will neither study war anymore. I still have a dream today," he said, "that one day the lamb and the lion will lie down together. I still have a dream that with our faith, we will be able to adjourn the councils of despair and bring new light into the dark chambers of pessimism. With our faith, we will be able to speed up the day where there will be peace on earth and goodwill. It'll be a glorious day, and the morning stars will sing together, and the sons of God will shout for joy. In every generation, we have sought peace, peace in several forms, peace with God, peace with each other, and peace within ourselves. The Hebrew word for peace is shalom. Its true meaning is not just the absence of conflict, but rather a culmination of living together in harmony with God, with each other, and even with ourselves. Wholeness, completeness, welfare, as well as tranquility. And during this season, leading up to Christmas, we reflect on the yearning of all God's people for the coming of the Messiah and the culmination of God's reign on earth. Jesus came years ago, God made flesh, light from light, wrapped in swaddling clothing, laying in a manger. Jesus enters humbly. Even as soldiers are harassing people to get to the census in their hometowns, the same soldiers who will harass the people and slaughter innocent children because King Herod will feel threatened by this new king. I always wondered, even as a child, why there were no Roman soldiers in the nativity set. Everything's beautiful. It's all peaceful. It's in the stable. And yet, even as we look at beautiful images of shepherds and angels just outside the door, there was this sound of army boots, people holding spears. The oppression of Rome was right outside that door. The prophets would foretell the birth, and the angels would declare peace on earth. But you and I, we live in a world that is weary. In the song, "O Holy Night," it says, "The weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn." Wouldn't you say that weary describes our world today? We are weary. Weary of economic stresses, weary of health concerns, weary of pandemic, weary of politics, weary of so many things. And yet, in the midst of that weariness, we have hope. We who declare that Christ is born anew, we have hope. On Christmas Day in 1863, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow wrote a poem. After his son had returned from the Civil War, a wounded, worn, and weary Union soldier. It's called, "I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day." The verses which he includes speak of his despair of hearing the promise of peace and yet looking around in the world at everything that contradicted it. He wrote, "And in despair, I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men." Then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail, with peace on earth, goodwill to men. References to peace abound in Christmas literature and scripture and song and prophecy. Isaiah showed us that image of the peaceable kingdom in Isaiah 11, where the animals and the creatures and even the children and the infants are all at peace. All are safe. They interact kindly, and even a child leads them. Paul tells us in Galatians that peace is actually a fruit of the Spirit. It is a quality, an attribute that should be evident in each Christian life. Peace with God, peace with others, peace within. I remember traveling to the Holy Land about 8 years ago, and we went to the Garden of Gethsemane. In fact, the stained glass window in our little side chapel depicts that garden prayer, that prayer of agony when Jesus says, "Not my will, but thine be done." In the Garden of Gethsemane, there are olive trees that are ancient, huge olive trees. It was the place of our Lord's prayer and that agony prayer. Jesus knew that the cross loomed large, that to bring peace and to bring healing and salvation was very costly. He concludes, "Not my will, but thine be done." In that same garden, near one of the oldest olive trees, there is the word peace written in stones. They said that Pope John Paul had it placed there. The word peace, even when we knew difficulty and strife in our world, prayers for peace in that garden, the garden where he agonized. The garden is beside a beautiful church called the Church of All Nations. The Garden of Gethsemane sits right next to the Church of All Nations. When you go into the church, beautiful mosaics everywhere, there is a crest of each nation on the ceiling. You know, crest of America, there's a crest of France, there's a crest of Germany. And you walk through this All Nations Church, and on one end, it has a mosaic of Jesus kneeling in the prayer and the agony in the garden. And on the other side, it has a picture of Jesus with Judas being kissed on the cheek. What does it say to us? In the Church of All Nations, this divine message of hope and peace. And yet, our Lord is not naive to the kiss of betrayal. This image of peace in the midst of pain is an image that we take to heart in Advent season. The hymn, "O Holy Night," recalls it this way. Truly, he taught us to love one another. His law is love and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother. And in his name, all oppression shall cease. There are images, nations, stories, peace stories of war. There was an interesting and fascinating story in World War I. Perhaps you heard it. It's depicted in a film called Joyous Noel. Soldiers from both the British and the German sides were singing carols in their own trenches, and they began to hear each other, and there was what was called the no man's land between them. The unofficial message was the Prince of Peace was being honored at that moment. And soon there was a German soldier with a beautiful baritone voice who got up out of the trench and sang Silent Night loud enough for all to hear. And the Germans began to put up small little trees and candles. And the British, they had a bagpipe they brought out, and they began to play along with him that song, Silent Night, Holy Night, Sleep in Heavenly Peace. It was called the Christmas Truce. It was particularly significant because it is recorded that 100,000 troops stopped that night. They stopped fighting, British and German and French, to worship the Prince of Peace. They even exchanged small gifts. They came out from the trenches to show peace. Now, peace may seem elusive at times, but when it breaks through, an otherwise weary world takes note. Places that seem to be maybe hard or difficult, places that we are surprised to find peace. There's a famous hymn called It Is Well With My Soul, written by a man named Horatio Spafford. And the story is that he and his family, after surviving the fire in Chicago, are going to travel over to Paris to celebrate Christmas. And he sends his family ahead of him to get prepared. And he's going to come over later. And his wife and four daughters are on a ship that collides with another ship. And the four daughters are killed. This tragic event, it took the lives of his four children, their only children. And his wife, Anna, wrote back and said, I am the only one saved. All else is lost. Now, most of us would face this tragedy with utter despair. Maybe anger and rage at God. How dare you let this happen to my family? But Horatio Spafford was an unusual man. He did not blame God. In fact, he said God is the only reason he survived it. When his wife returned, he had written a song, It Is Well With My Soul. He writes, when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. That image of faith and being at peace in ourselves, no matter what our circumstances might be, is that revelation of what God can do in us. He and his wife Anna later moved from Chicago to Jerusalem, and they had a few more children, and they hosted and built a soup kitchen for refugees, an orphanage, a children's hospital. They took what was tragic in their life and they flipped it. They flipped it to make it a sign of hope for others. This is the way God brings peace. The human condition may not seem prone to peace. One psychologist talked about inner peace, and she said, even in childhood, the disturbance of peace, where trauma or abuse or a toxic message has robbed us of peace, is what she called the dance of assaults. And the only remedy, the only way that we can be at peace is to get care and healing before we continue that act of assault on others. From an early age, we know the difference between peace and chaos, peace and conflict. Until we know healing ourselves, they say, we may bleed on people who did not cut us. We must find peace so that we are not harming others. Peace involves learning better ways to address our real concerns without resorting to violence or hurtful events. You see, violence can come physically or verbally. We who follow Christ must always be a sign of peace to others. Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers." Our hymn today, just after this sermon, has a beautiful tribute to peace as well. "For lo, the days are hastening on, by prophets seen of old, when with the ever-circling years shall come the time foretold, when peace shall over all the earth its ancient splendors fling, and the whole world send back the song which now the angels sing." Jesus told us, "In me you can find peace. In the world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us pray. O Lord, we do come before you, Prince of Peace, to pray for peace within us, between each other, and with God. Help us, O God, to know that peace that resides as a sign of hope, a signal of your presence and power, even in our darkest hour. Help us, O God, to be your faithful people, a people who are peacemakers, a people who are signs and symbols of your light and your love and your presence here in our midst. O Lord, we offer our prayer in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our hymn is, Let There Be Peace on Earth.
Be gracious to you, the Lord. turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. 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 The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Generations in your family and your children and the children and the children.
May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He's with you, he's with you.
In the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing.
Let us receive God's blessing. What a gift of peace. A little child should lead them, and that child is Jesus Christ, our Lord. May he give to you the peace that passes all understanding. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.